Welcome back. I'm Robert Breaker, and this week's sermon is going to be on the topic of the rapture of the church. Now, there are many people today, many of them all over YouTube, that say there's no such thing as the rapture. As a matter of fact, I've been getting emails from people saying, well, Brother Breaker, you're just wrong. There's no rapture. So there are many people today that claim there is no rapture of the church. Are they right? Others say there's no such thing as a pre-tribulational rapture. Rather, they believe in either a mid-tribulation rapture or a post-tribulation rapture. So you have all these different theories floating around, and different people want to argue about whether or not there is a rapture, and then if there is a rapture, when it's going to take place. So what I want to do today is I want to throw up here what the Bible says about this. We're going to look at the Bible, what the Bible literally says about the rapture. But there are three theories of the rapture. The first one is called the pre-tribulational rapture. I'm going to just go ahead and write them all up here. This is the first one, the pre-tribulation rapture, which is, of course, the teaching that the rapture takes place before the tribulation period. The second one is the mid-tribulation rapture, which people today believe that the rapture is not going to take place before the tribulation. They say it takes place in the middle of the tribulation. Then you have number three, the post-tribulational rapture, which is kind of weird, where people think that the rapture is going to take place at the end, the very end of the tribulation period. So let me go ahead and write these up here for us. The number one is a pre-tribulation, I'll just abbreviate, pre-tribulation rapture. Number two is what they call a mid-tribulation rapture. But the mid-tribulation rapture is also called the pre-wrath rapture. Now, I've made a video about the pre-wrath rapture that some have seen already. And this is right here is the tribulation. It's a seven-year period. Some break it up into 3.5 years and 3.5 years. And so the last 3.5 years, they say, is when God's wrath is poured out upon the earth. And so those that believe in a mid-tribulation rapture call it a pre-wrath rapture because they say that we get out before the wrath of the final 3.5 years. And that's what they believe. They believe in a mid-tribulation rapture, which they call a pre-wrath rapture. And then the final theory is that there's no rapture. So here are the four theories or teachings today that if you look within Christianity that have to do with the rapture. Some, like myself, believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. And by the way, this has been the teaching of the church that has been most believed for the longest period of time. Now, I know someone would say, well, that's not true, but if you study the Bible and you study Paul, then I can dogmatically say Paul believed in a pre-tribulation rapture. In many of his books that we've been going through verse by verse, Paul is always talking about our gathering together unto him. Paul was waiting for the rapture in his day, waiting to go up with those people that he'd led to the Lord. So Paul was waiting for a pre-tribulational rapture. So you have the pre-tribulational rapture, the mid-tribulational rapture, the post-tribulation rapture, and then those that say there's no rapture whatsoever. So which is right? Many are emailing me and asking me, which one do you believe and which one is right? So let's look at this and let's see what the Bible has to say about the rapture. Now, in all fairness, we need to make sure we make this point. First of all, the word rapture is not in the Bible. Those who are against the rapture and say there's no rapture whatsoever, they cry aloud, the word rapture is not in the Bible, so it's not a Bible doctrine. Really? Well, you know, the word Trinity is not in the Bible either, but it is a Bible doctrine. And the Trinity is one God with three parts. You can prove that easily from the Scriptures. God is one God with three parts. And instead of the word Trinity, the Bible uses the word Godhead. The Godhead is one God with three parts. So just because a word is not in the Bible doesn't mean that the doctrine is not in the Bible. There are some teachings in the Bible that men have put a name on. And the word rapture is a word that men have made up to refer to the time when Jesus takes out the church. Now, if you want to find it in the rapture in the Bible, and it is there under a different name. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 1, the rapture is not called rapture, it's called gathering. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 1 says, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto Him." Another place in the Bible when it talks about the rapture, it says appearing. So we have different words for the rapture. We have the word gathering. We have the word coming of Jesus Christ. And we have the word, what was the last one I said? The appearing. So just because the word rapture is not in the Bible does not mean that the doctrine is not in the Bible. The doctrine of the rapture is in the Bible and is referred to as the gathering together of God's people, the church, to be taken up before God. It is called the coming. Jesus comes for His bride. And it is the appearing. Jesus appears at the rapture, takes the bride up, and then goes back up to heaven. So just because you don't find the word rapture in the Bible doesn't mean you throw out the entire doctrine. The doctrine is there under another name. So the rapture doctrine is in the Bible. Those who say it is not are wrong. And I've watched some of those people, and I've watched some of their videos on YouTube, and I don't know whether to laugh or cry. They sound like demons roaring and screaming and crying against the coming of Jesus Christ. I don't know if a demon would sound any worse than that. Demons hate the doctrine of the rapture because they know it's going to take place. And so watch out. Be warned. Watch out for wolves in sheep's clothing that say there's no such thing as the rapture. Matter of fact, let's go to Acts chapter 1, verse 11. The teaching of the rapture is found all throughout the scriptures. You cannot deny the fact that Jesus said He will return, and when He does, He's going to gather someone unto Him. He will take someone to Him. He will take them out. Now, in Acts chapter 1 and verse 11, we see Jesus going up into heaven. And as He goes up, verse 11, these two men, which were angels, stood by them in white peril. And in verse 11, we read in Acts 1, verse 11, "Which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you in heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen Him go into heaven." So as Jesus went up into heaven, He's coming back. And when He comes back, He's going to come back for someone to gather them together unto Him. He's going to rapture them out. Now, I'm not going to run to the Greek. There's a lot of people that like to run to the Greek. I learned Greek, and I forgot it on purpose because I don't like Greek. I have a King James Bible. I don't need Greek. The King James Bible, as far as I believe and far as I'm concerned, was translated correctly from the right text. And I don't have time to go into that today, but watch my video about that, where the King James Bible comes from. So you won't hear me running to the Greek, but just so you know, some people will run to the Greek and say that the rapture is the harpso, or I think that's the word, harpso. And they say that's the word for rapture in the Bible, and it means a snatching away, or it's a taking and pulling out. Now, I don't want to run to the Greek. I'm just going to refer to it in English as the rapture, or as the Bible text itself calls it, the gathering, the coming, or the appearing of Jesus Christ. And so what we're going to do today, we're going to look at the rapture. And we're going to see what the Bible says about the rapture. And here in Acts 1:11, it says that He went up in the clouds. And I want you to remember this. Jesus went up in the clouds. When He comes back at the rapture, He'll come back in the clouds, as we see, or will see, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. But the rapture is not only given in the Bible, in the epistles of Paul, as we shall see, but even Jesus alludes to the rapture Himself in the book of John. Now, when we go to the first four books in the New Testament, the Gospels, I've said it many times, and I believe it because it's the truth, you have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. These four are the Gospels. And Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are still Old Testament because Jesus had not died yet. The New Testament does not start until Jesus literally dies on the cross. So everything you're reading in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is still Old Testament. And it's for the Jews. But there's something very different about the book of John. One of these days I'd like to preach a message on how the four Gospels portray Jesus. Because John is a very different Gospel than the other three. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are very Jewish in their context. And they're writing to Jews, trying to prove to Jews that Jesus was their Messiah. But John, and by the way, Matthew, Mark, Luke were all written relatively close to the time of Jesus after He died. They wrote Matthew, Mark, and Luke very soon after Jesus died. What happened? Their Gospels. John was written a little later. And so what we see in the book of John is something a little bit different. We see things in the book of John that are not found anywhere in Matthew, Mark, or Luke. John has gone over here in the church age and learned some things, especially from Paul. And then when he went right back and he wrote the book of John, he wrote a couple things in John that weren't in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And they have to do with the church age and the body of Christ. So it was like he was taking the doctrine of Paul and then backwriting John in order to kind of throw in there a little bit in a couple of places the body of Christ. Let me give you an example of that. John chapter 10, verse 16. This is not mentioned in any of the other Gospels. John 10:16. This is John quoting Jesus and says, "And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd." Now Jesus, when he came, he said, "I'm only coming for the Jews." This is the only time in any of the Gospels where Jesus says, "Yeah, I'm only coming for the Jews, but then I've got some other people too that I'm going to bring into my fold." Wink, wink. Like Jesus foreshadowing and telling that that's going to take place. What took place? What took place? Jews and Gentiles were saved into the body of Christ. And God used Peter more for Jews and Paul more for Gentiles, even though each one preached to both Jew and Gentile alike. So when you have the book of John, you have a book that's a little bit different. So there's some things in John that we can look at today and that do apply to the church age and to us today, even though they were said in the Old Testament. Because John really got a hold of the message of Paul and wrote some things. Now, let me give you an example. John chapter 14, verses 1 through 3. John 14, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." Jesus Christ is speaking, and he's talking to the early disciples, who eventually would be part of the body of Christ, the church. And he says unto them, "In my Father's house are many mansions." Now, if you don't have a King James Bible, then you don't have a mansion. Because new versions of the Bible say there's many rooms. What would you rather have, a room or a mansion? I'd rather have a mansion. And I don't think there's just rooms in heaven. If heaven is as great as the Bible proclaims, then they're all going to be mansions. Amen? So it says, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." So Jesus, when he dies, he says, "After I die, I'm going to go up to heaven with a purpose. I'm going to go up there and prepare a place for somebody." And then he says here in verse 3, "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Bingo, right there. There it is, the rapture. Jesus says, "I'm going away to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare that place, guess what? I'm going to come back, and I'm going to receive you unto my own. I'm going to rapture you out and take you up to heaven with me." Now that's the rapture. Now yes, it's found in the book of John. But like I said, John adopted the teachings of Paul and kind of back wrote the book of John and inserted some things that he remembered Jesus saying that the other disciples didn't remember. Because Jesus was talking about his kingdom and coming in his kingdom, and they all thought, well, he's going to set up his literal kingdom right there. But John, the Bible says, was the one that was closest to the Lord, that loved the Lord, and there were some things that I think, personally, that Jesus only told John in secret, that he didn't tell the others. And you can prove that easily from the Bible, because when they're together at the Last Supper, well, this John was leaning up on God's breast. And they ask him, who's the one that's going to betray them? And he kind of says, Lord, who's going to betray? And he's so close, it's almost like Jesus whispered in his ear. So God revealed a couple things unto John that he didn't reveal to the other disciples. And when John wrote his gospel, he was writing to Jews, but there were some things that he included in his book that do apply out here in the church age. And so you do have kind of a little wink or a little hint of Jesus hinting that there will be a rapture in the future. And that the rapture will be when Jesus, when he goes up, he comes and he takes these out to come to receive unto himself. So don't tell me there's no rapture in the Bible. It's there. It's there. So at any rate, God did promise to come again. Even in chapter 14, again, of John. John chapter 14, verse 27, Jesus says, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you." Verse 27, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." Verse 28, "Ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If you loved me, you would rejoice because I said, I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. So Jesus says, I go away and I come again. When he comes again, he comes at the rapture to do what? To take them unto himself. That's what the rapture is for. We who are saved, we will go up with Jesus to our mansions in heaven when he comes at the rapture. Now let's look at how we know there's a rapture. This should be enough. I mean, you should listen to the words of Jesus. He foreshadowed and told that there will be a future time, and that even though he left, he will come back and take those that are his unto himself. So you should listen to the words of Jesus. If you deny the rapture, then you're denying the words of Jesus Christ, and that's not good. But what else? What are some other things that we can look at? Now, first of all, the rapture. All right, what I want to do here is I want to put my points, and I've got so much to write up here today, but the first way we know there's a rapture is because of what Jesus said. And we just read that. I'm going to put up here, I think, seven different points that point to a rapture in the Bible. So the first thing is Jesus said he would come again to receive someone unto himself. So what is he doing to receive them unto himself means he's gathering them unto himself. He's taking them up to him. The second thing that proves there's a rapture is the two comings of Jesus Christ. Now, I have a video on YouTube you can watch when you get a chance called The Two Comings of Jesus Christ. And basically what I do is I show the two times that Jesus comes and how there's two parts to each coming of Jesus Christ. And that video shows that very well. I don't want to get into that too much, but let me just briefly mention that. When Jesus Christ comes the first time, his first coming, he comes at his birth to be born of a virgin. So that's part one of his coming. Now, the Bible tells us that when Jesus died on the cross, he was buried. He was buried, and then the Bible says he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. And then we're told that he went up into heaven, and then he came back. So when Jesus went up into heaven, then he comes right back down, and he stays on the earth, the Bible says, for, 40 days, I believe. So this is the second part of his coming. What did I write it down here? I'll just put number two. So the first time Jesus came, he came twice. Now I have the verses here. I don't know if I have time to go to them. I might as well. We're in John. Go to John chapter 20 and verse 17. John chapter 20 and verse 17. Jesus had just risen from the dead, and then Mary looks at him and sees him. And Jesus said, touch me not, I am not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father and my God and your God. So Jesus had just risen from the dead here on earth, and he tells Mary, I'm about to ascend up into heaven. So Jesus went up. Then what happens? Well, then in verse 19, then the same day at even, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said unto them, peace be unto you. So here Jesus is back. So he came first born of a virgin, then he died, and he went up to heaven, and then he came back in his resurrected body. And the Bible tells us he was here for 40 days. I believe that's in verse. Well, I'll have to find that verse. But he's here for 40 days on the earth. And he's teaching the disciples and talking with them. So if there's two parts to the first coming of Jesus Christ, would it not stand to reason that there's two parts to the second coming of Jesus Christ? I mean, if he came twice the first time, he's going to come twice the second time. And the second time he comes, how does he come? He comes here at the rapture. So Jesus comes at the rapture, and that's the first part of his second coming. And then he comes back over here at Armageddon. And that's part two of his coming. So two parts to the first coming of Jesus, two parts to the second coming of Jesus. It just makes sense. So why would someone say, no, there's no rapture? Well, then you have destroyed the type of how there's two parts to the first coming and two parts of the second coming. So the first time Jesus Christ came, at his birth, he came born as a lamb. He's the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. He came born as a baby. And he died as the sacrificial lamb. Well, the next time Jesus comes, the Bible talks about Jesus coming at the rapture for a reason. A lot of people believe in the rapture, but they've never really thought about why the rapture is there. The rapture is so that Jesus can get his bride, the church. It's the bridegroom. So when Jesus comes the second time, the first time, he comes as the bridegroom for his bride. Behold, the bridegroom cometh. When he comes back in Armageddon over here, he comes as a lion. So the first part of Jesus coming, he's come as a baby born of a virgin. And he dies as the lamb. He goes up to heaven as the sacrificial lamb of God and comes back down and spends some time with his disciples before eventually in Acts 1:11 being raised back up into heaven. The second time Jesus comes, he comes as the bridegroom. Then he takes his church out. And then he comes back as a lion. And what does he do? Well, he's the lion of the tribe of Judah, and he's angry like a lion, and he's coming to destroy his enemies at the battle of Armageddon. So he's coming as the king. So there are two parts to each coming of Jesus Christ, and that clearly, clearly proves that there must be a rapture. Because if there were two parts to the first coming, there must be two parts to the second coming. Next, a lot of people that don't believe in a rapture, or maybe they're wrong on their belief in the rapture, believing not in a pre-tribulation rapture, but rather a mid-tribulation or post-tribulation rapture, these people don't believe in dispensations. But the Bible clearly teaches there is a thing called dispensations. And if you understand dispensations and right division, or rightly dividing the Bible, as the Bible tells us, rightly dividing the word of truth, when you go through your Bible and you rightly divide, you cannot help but see the rapture and how there must be a rapture according to the Bible. So what we do is we go to the Bible and read it, and we find out there's a book in the Bible called the Book of Acts. And the Book of Acts, is a transitional book. And as we're reading the Bible and understanding and rightly dividing, we see clearly that transition in the book of Acts. So we read the Bible, we rightly divide, and we see the different time periods and the different ways. You know, dispensations isn't just a time period, it's also a different way in which God deals with different people. So when Jesus showed up in his earthly ministry before he died on the cross, who did he come to? Well, Jesus says clearly in Matthew 15:24, he said, "I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." So Jesus dogmatically makes it clear, here in my ministry, I am only here for Jews, nobody else. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 5 through 6, Jesus commands his disciples, look, do not go to the Gentiles, only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Only to the house of Israel. So Jesus' ministry was only to Jews and Jews only. And when those early disciples went out preaching, their ministry was only to Jews as well. Their ministry in the Bible is called the Apostles' Doctrine. And I've got a video on that, the Apostles' Doctrine. Do you good to watch it if you haven't seen it yet, because it shows the Apostles' Doctrine and how that's so different from our doctrine today. Because today we have the Apostle Paul. Why is Paul in the Bible? Because the Jews rejected their Messiah. You see, the Apostles' doctrine was repent, be baptized, and do right because you killed your Messiah. That's not the gospel of today. We don't believe that Jesus is the Messiah and that gets us saved and go to heaven. Now, we should know and believe that Jesus was the Messiah of Israel, but the very fact that I believe Jesus is the Messiah, that's not what gets me to heaven. What gets me to heaven is trusting the gospel that God revealed unto Paul. So it's the gospel that saves us, and it's grace through faith in the finished work of Christ. Grace through faith in the gospel. The gospel was revealed unto Paul in 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. That's what saves us today. I am not saved by Acts 2:38. There's a transition, there is a change. So the book of Acts is a transitional book, and it changes. It's a book that changes from Peter to Paul. From Israel to the church. And from Jews to Gentiles. Because as you read the book of Acts, you see clearly that the nation of Israel as a whole rejected their Messiah. And that's when God said, okay, Paul, Well, actually, he told Peter first, Peter, there's going to be some Gentiles coming to visit you. You go with them and you go preach. You go tell them something. He goes, not so, Lord. You told us way back here, don't go to any Gentile. God says, yeah, this is different. There's been a change. So now you go talk to these Gentiles. And what happened? They got saved and they got the Holy Ghost. So as you read your Bible, as you rightly divide, as you understand dispensations, you find out that there's been a change in the book of Acts, and we're no longer under this apostles' doctrine where you're saved by water baptism. We're saved over here by what Paul preached, and we're saved by grace through faith alone. Amen? We're saved by trusting the gospel of salvation. It's God's grace and our faith in His shed blood that saves us today. So you've got to get that. So Jesus' ministry was to Jews only. The early disciples or apostles, too, were only to Jews at the first. They had the apostles' doctrine. But as the book of Acts continued, you see the nation of Israel rejecting their Messiah and falling away. And that's why God chose Paul, because God said, Paul, I want you to go preach this message to this other people, the other fold. Remember Jesus back here in John saying, I have another fold, that another flock that I'm going to bring into the fold, if you will. So when we go to Romans chapter 11, we clearly see the Apostle Paul telling us this. Romans chapter 11, verse 11. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid. Who's he talking about? Israel. God forbid, but rather through their fall, salvation is come unto the Gentiles to provoke them to jealousy. So the Jews, Israel, fell from their Messiah and from salvation and from having the kingdom set up. And because of that, God says, now I'm going to take to the Gentiles this gospel of salvation to provoke them to jealousy. Verse 12, now if the fall of them be the riches of the world, the diminishing of them, the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? Verse 13, Paul says, for I speak to you Gentiles, and as much as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify my office. Now, some people will run with that and say, now God is so done with the Jews that he's never going to go back to dealing with the Jews. And so all the promises to Israel are to the church. That's called replacement theology. And it says God is done with the Jews and God will never go back to dealing with the Jews ever again. Then what the heck is the tribulation for? The tribulation is called Daniel's 70th week. It's also called the time of Jacob's trouble. Who's Jacob? Israel. And what does the Bible say? Well, we're here in the chapter. Let's go here. Verse 25 through 28. God tells us clearly that he is not done with Israel. It says here in Romans 11:25, for I would not, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. So today the Jews are blind until the fullness of the Gentiles be saved, be fulfilled, or come in. And then it says, and so all Israel shall be saved, as is written, there shall come out of Zion the Deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. And on and on and on. So there is a time when God will go back to dealing with the nation of Israel. And that takes place after the rapture. Now I know there's some people on YouTube that preach that that's not true. They believe that there's no such thing as a Jew left, and that God's done with the Jews. Well, that's very much against the teachings of the Bible. And that's not what the Bible teaches. So there were some mysteries revealed to Paul. So what I'll write up here is I'll write up the mysteries to Paul. So here we have how we know there's a rapture in the Bible. Because first Jesus said he was coming back for his own, to receive them unto himself. We see the two comings. When Jesus came the first time, he came twice. When Jesus comes again, he's coming back two different times. So there's two stages, I guess is the way to say it, or two parts to each of Jesus' coming. The first coming, two parts. The second coming in two parts. We looked at rightly dividing the word of truth. We look at dispensations. We see clearly that there was a time in which God was dealing with the Jews, but the Jews said, forget it. So God starts dealing with the Gentiles under this gospel. But now, we find what's called the mysteries. I've got a message on YouTube, seven different teachings about the seven mysteries in the Bible. And these were things that God only revealed to Paul. And one of them, we just read, that blindness in part has happened to Israel. So God's done with the Jews for today, but he's not done with them forever. the rapture comes to take out his bride so that God can go back to dealing with the Jews in Daniel's 70th week, or the time of Jacob's trouble. And that's what the tribulation is for. Now, there were some mysteries that God revealed unto Paul. And one of those mysteries had to do with the body, or the church. Let's go to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, in verse 24 through 28, we read, "Who now rejoice in my sufferings for you, and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh, for his body's sake, which is the church." The church is the body of Christ. The body of Christ is the church. "Whereof," Paul is speaking, "I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given me to you to fulfill the word of God." Now, somebody sent me a video the other day where a guy says, "I don't believe in there's dispensations. There's no such thing as dispensations. That's a lie." And yet, here's the word, dispensation. But anyway, verse 26. "Even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints." Verse 27, "to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory." Now notice what he says here in verse 28, "whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Jesus Christ." Paul says that this is the church age. This is when people can get saved. Either Jew or Gentile, they have to come through this gospel. I had someone send me an email just a little while ago and said, "Well, I'm a Jew. How do I get saved today?" Well, Paul says, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the power of God and the salvation to the Jew first and also to the Greek." Salvation today is 1:16, I believe it is to Jew and Gentile, like through the gospel of Paul. That's Romans 1:16. But today, when you're saved, you become part of the body of Christ. And Paul says that the work of the body of Christ is that all people get in the body so that he might present them to Jesus. So there's another word which is speaking about the rapture. It's presenting someone to Jesus. When do they get presented perfect in Christ? At the rapture. So all throughout the scriptures are the rapture, and it all goes to Paul, and it was a mystery revealed to Paul. So you have to understand. So as we read through Paul's epistles, we find two different passages that clearly speak of the rapture of the church. Let's go to the first one, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. This is speaking of the rapture of the church. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13 through 18, the Apostle Paul says, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope." Now, what does it mean to be asleep? When a person dies who is saved, the Bible says, "absent from the body, present with the Lord." So his soul goes to heaven when he dies, and his body stays here on earth, and it's buried. So the body is asleep, but the soul is very much alive and awake and in heaven. There's people that say, "That's not true, it's soul sleep. When you die, your soul just sleeps in your body." That's ridiculous. You go back to Genesis. I believe it's around chapter 35 or 38. I'd have to look it up. But I think it's Rachel who died. And the Bible says that when Rachel died, it says her soul was in departing. When a person dies, the soul leaves their body. So if a person is lost and they die, then their soul leaves their body and goes straight down to hell, and their soul is burning in hell. And the body is asleep in the grave. You go out to just about any cemetery and look, and most of the gravestones say R.I.P., rest in peace. Why? Because they're sleeping. The body is said to be asleep in the grave. So that's what happens. If you're saved, your soul departs when you die, your body goes to the grave, and your soul, absent from the body, present with the Lord, is in heaven with Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible teaches. Now it says here, "it would not have them ignorant concerning them which are asleep." Verse 14, "For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain at the coming of the Lord shall not present them which are asleep." The Apostle Paul says, we who are alive when the rapture comes. That shows you that Paul was hoping that the rapture would be during his day. So that shows you that the Apostle Paul was a pre-tribulation believer in the rapture. Because he thought it would come while he was still alive. But it didn't. He died way, way, way back here. But whether he was dead or alive, asleep, he's still going to go. Because when the rapture comes, the souls of those saved in heaven will come back here, and their bodies will meet in the air, and they'll have a glorified body. The Bible calls that the redemption of the body. You see, when we're saved, our soul is saved by the blood of Jesus, but our body's not saved. That's why when we die, the body goes to the grave. The day the body gets saved is at the rapture, when we get a glorified body. But notice that he says, we, verse 15, for this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we, which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord, shall not prevent them which are asleep. Paul was expecting during his lifetime, hoping that the rapture would be then. And he was saying, I'm going to be one of those that might not die and go at the rapture. And then he says in verse 16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. That's the dead bodies of those that were saints rising up to meet their soul in the air. And then it says, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together. Again, he says we, to meet them in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. So we that are alive and remain. Paul was expecting and hoping in his day that he would be one of those that didn't die and could make it till the rapture of the church. What does that teach us? That the rapture must come before the tribulation. And that Paul was a pre-tribulational teacher of the rapture. Don't give me this garbage that, oh, the pre-tribulation idea only came, you know, in the 1800s with Darby, and it's just, no! Paul believed in a pre-tribulational rapture because he thought he'd be one of them to be raptured out. Well, a lot of people just don't read the Bible, I guess. Verse 18, wherefore comfort one another with these words. So, that's one passage that talks about the rapture. Now let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, here is another chapter and another passage from the Apostle Paul in which he tells us what the rapture will be like and what takes place at the rapture. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. The body is the problem. It's a corrupt body with corrupt blood. So he says, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? So here we have the Apostle Paul talking about the rapture, which he calls a mystery. And he says, in that mystery, flesh and blood will be changed into an incorruptible body. So what the rapture is for God to give us our glorified bodies. You see, when you're saved, your soul's saved. You know what's not saved? Your body. Your body doesn't get saved until the rapture. So if you die, your soul goes to heaven and your body sleeps in the grave. And you're waiting for the rapture when Jesus calls up your body and it's resurrected and puts your soul back in it and gives you a glorified body just like the body of Jesus Christ when he rose from the dead. An incorruptible body. So don't give me this garbage that there's no rapture in the Bible. Paul clearly teaches that there's a rapture in the Bible. And these people that say there's no such thing as a rapture, it's because they don't rightly divide, they don't believe in dispensations, and they don't go to Paul. They all conveniently leave out the Apostle Paul and want nothing to do with Paul. And they do so to their own detriment. So the rapture is in the Bible. It's one of the mysteries revealed by God to the Apostle Paul. Why was it revealed by God to Paul? Well, that's simple. Because it has to do with the church. This is the church. And God revealed the doctrine for the church for us today. So the heart of the New Testament doctrine are the epistles of Paul. And the mysteries, the revelations to Paul. So God revealed to Paul, hey Paul, this is the church. This is the body of Christ. And this is when you present them to me. And they get their glorified bodies. This is the rapture. I hope you get that. A lot of people don't know how to rightly divide the word of truth. Now, I did a video called The Postponement Theory. If you haven't seen that, please look up The Postponement Theory. It actually should be called The Postponement Fact, because I prove from the Bible what this postponement is. And what it is when Jesus Christ came, he came to Israel with a promise to set up a millennial kingdom for 1,000 years and reign over them. But his ministry, he was rejected by the Jews. And he sent his disciples, the apostles, out, and they rejected him as them as well. And Israel as a nation rejected their Messiah. And so God started what I like to call a parenthetical thing. He set this thing up in such a way that the Jews were set aside and the kingdom was postponed. And now God's going and dealing more with Gentiles. Now, yes, Jews can still be saved. And by the way, the body of Christ starts at the cross, okay? But because of the rejection, here's where this postponement, Acts chapter 8, the apostle Stephen is preaching. Well, actually, he's a deacon. And chapter 7, excuse me. And he says to the Jews, you know, this is Jesus, you guys killed him. And they stoned him. And the Bible says Jesus was in heaven standing on the right hand of God. Why was Jesus Christ standing in Acts chapter 7? Because he could have come back right there and started up his millennial kingdom if all those Jews would have got down on their knees and cried out to God and said, "You're right, you're right, you're right, we killed the Messiah, we're sorry." Because they did it, then God says, "Okay, now to Gentiles." This parenthetical period, this postponement of the kingdom message and the kingdom to the Jews, ends at the rapture. Because in the book of Daniel, chapter 9, the Bible talks about the 70 weeks of Israel. 69 weeks took place all the way up here to when Jesus died. So there's 1 week of years, not a week of days, a week of years, 7 years, still future, that are still applying to Israel as a nation that have not taken place yet. So something has to take place for God to go right back to dealing with Israel. What could that be? The rapture. The church needs to be taken out so that things will start up again right where they left off in Acts chapter 7 with old Stephen's preaching. And Jesus goes back to dealing with his nation of Israel. So I teach and I believe and I preach in a pre-tribulation rapture, because the rapture is to take out the church so that God can then go back to dealing with his people Israel. If anybody teaches anything any different, then they're not a dispensationalist, they don't rightly divide the word of truth, and they don't come to Paul, who is their apostle. And they don't see the mysteries to Paul. They don't see the prophecies must be fulfilled back there in Daniel. And so the church age is this parenthetical time in which the postponement has taken place of the kingdom to out here. Oh, so much more that I could say, amen. But the church must leave for God to go back to dealing with Israel so that the 70th week of Daniel can continue. Now, how about this? The order of the books in the Bible. The order of the books of the Bible and the types in the Bible. If you have a King James Bible, believe it or not, you have a pre-tribulational order of the books in your Bible. The Bible is put together in such a way by the King James translators who believed in a pre-tribulational rapture that they put the books in order of a pre-tribulational rapture. And when you look at the books in the Bible in order of when they are there and what they talk about, in type, you cannot help to come to any other conclusion but a pre-tribulational rapture. Let me show you. The first four books in the Old Testament are Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, and there. That's the first seven. So Genesis to Judges, the first seven books in the Bible. Isn't it interesting that Judges is the seventh book of the Bible, and it was apostasy in that book? And it says every man did that which was right in his own eyes, and there was apostasy. Well, in the church age, it ends right here with what? A time of apostasy. So Genesis through Judges lines up with the seven churches, I guess you could say, or the church age. What's the very next book after Judges? It's the book of Ruth. What is the book of Ruth about? The book of Ruth is about a woman who needs to be redeemed. Well, the church age is all about Paul preaching and winning people to the Lord, and those people get saved and they become part of the body of Christ. Once you're saved, you become part of the body of Christ. What is the body of Christ? It's called the church. But it's also called the bride of Christ. So the church is the bride, and a bride is a woman. So God died on the cross for a woman. And one day, the rapture, he comes as the bridegroom to take out his bride. And guess what he does? He redeems her. Because the Bible calls the rapture the day of redemption. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 30. That's when our body is redeemed. And we have the redemption of our body. We're crying now, Abba Father, but then we receive the redemption of our body. The day of, I wrote redeemed, the day of redemption. That's what the Bible calls the rapture. Until the day of redemption, when our body is redemed. Well, from there you have 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, 2 Kings, 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles. So those books of 1 Samuel all the way to 2 Chronicles, they all talk about all these different kings. But the main theme in 1 Samuel to 2 Chronicles is a good king or bad king first, and then a good king. That's the main theme of those books. Over and over it mentions Saul, David. Saul, David. Each one of those books talks about Saul, David. And what it says is the bad king came first, then the good king. What happens in the order of history? First comes the Antichrist, the bad king, then comes Jesus Christ, the good king. What's the next books? Ezra and Nehemiah. Do you know what the books of Ezra and Nehemiah are about? In the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, the Jews are fighting a battle and defending their homeland, and they're building their temple. All that's in the news today among many Christians is the Jews want to rebuild their temple. The Jews want to rebuild their temple. Why? Well, because after the rapture, they go back to God, and they seek God, and they rebuild the temple, and they do sacrifice thinking, hey, we're going to come back to God. And God's going to go, that's not, you're rejected the one sacrifice that saves you. And then he's going to send some witnesses, 144,000 witnesses, and the two witnesses. And he's going to say, look, this is the Messiah, Jesus Christ. But isn't that interesting? Ezra and Nehemiah, one of them builds the city, one of them the wall, and one of them builds the temple. And we're waiting for the Jews to build their temple today. What's the next book? The next book in the Old Testament is the book of Esther. Have you ever read the book of Esther? Do you know what the book of Esther is about? The book of Esther is about a queen who's a Gentile. And the Gentile queen has to be taken out of the equation because she's become really bad. And then the king marries a Jewish queen. So Vashti, the bad woman, would be a type of the church being raptured out. And then God going to Esther, going back to Israel, his people. And on and on and on. There's so many other books there. The next one is the book of Job. The book of Job has exactly 42 chapters. Wasn't that something? 42 is the number of months there are in 3.5 years. And the book of Job is all about a guy who was trying to do right, suffering. And that sounds just like the Jews in the last 3.5 years of the tribulation, suffering. And on and on and on. We have all the other books, many of the major and minor prophets. One of my old pastors says that 90% of the major old and major and minor prophets, 90% of them all talk about the day of the Lord, which has to do with Armageddon and the millennial kingdom. So the Old Testament is in order of not only history, but of it portrays a pre-tribulational rapture, because the order and the types in those books show us, oh, there's going to be a rapture takes place here. How about the New Testament? Does the New Testament do the same thing? Sure. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Then you have the book of Acts. All right, here's Acts. Well, from Acts, we have the books of Paul, Romans 2, and instead of putting Philemon, I'm going to put Romans to Titus. Because the interesting thing, in Titus 2:13, it says, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. What is he telling us to look for? The rapture. The next book that Paul wrote is the book of Philemon. Have you ever read the book of Philemon? The book of Philemon is about this slave that ran away from its master. And Paul finds that slave and tells that slave, look, go back to your master, apologize to your master, and beg him to take you back. The Jews run away from their Messiah and reject him. The church age takes place. Rapture comes, takes out the church, and what are the Jews going to do? They're going to beg Jesus Christ, sorry that we assassinated you, sorry we killed you, we believe you're the Messiah, save us, we're sorry. Whew. Next book that Paul wrote was the book of Hebrews. What's a Hebrew? It's a Jew. A lot of stuff in the book of Hebrews that sounds like it applies to the tribulation rather than the church age. Then you've got the rest of the books of the Bible. I don't have time to get into them. 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1, 2, 3 John, all those. Revelation. What does Revelation talk about? It starts out talking about church, then it ends up all over here with the millennium and everything else. So more or less, the Bible, the books of the Bible, are in order. And the order that the books of the Bible point to is a pre-tribulational order of the books of the Bible. And you can't make this stuff up. Final thing I want to say is that you've got to see Paul. You've got to look at Paul. And you've got to look at time in order to understand all this. Now, many, many people who do not believe in the rapture whatsoever will run to Matthew chapter 24, which was back here in Jesus' ministry. And they will say, well, Jesus Christ was speaking about when he comes back, and he does not mention a rapture at all. And because of that, there must not be a rapture. Well, guess what they just did? They forgot Paul. Because God revealed the mystery of the rapture to Paul. So if you throw Paul out of the Bible, then of course you're not going to believe in the rapture. All you're going to believe in is the words of Jesus. And when Jesus was speaking in Matthew 24, he was speaking of his coming, of the second stage of his coming. He was speaking of Armageddon. Jesus wasn't speaking of the rapture here in Matthew chapter 24. Let me show you that. Matthew 24:29. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heaven shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. When does Jesus Christ come with power and great glory? At Armageddon. And then it says in verse 31, he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds from one end of heaven to the other. Look at verse 50. Again, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of. And he shall cut him asunder and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. If you take the Apostle Paul and you throw him out of the Bible, then you don't have the rapture. You miss that revelation and that mystery. And so you're reading through Jesus, and all you see is the future coming of Jesus with power, when he's coming in gnashing of teeth, when he's coming in Armageddon, and you don't see the rapture. Now, other people get it wrong, and other people say, well, this is the rapture. Matthew 24, Jesus is talking about the rapture. Now, wait a minute. How can Jesus be speaking of the rapture in Matthew 24, if that's back here before he died, if the rapture had not been revealed yet to the Apostle Paul way over here? But there are some people out there, they say, well, it says here, you know, the trumpet will blow. So when the trumpet blows, that trumpet is the last trump that Paul talks about. Well, why would Paul talk about the last trump as the rapture? That's not the trumpet that Paul's talking about. Matter of fact, many people today have learned that the Jews have a feast. And one of the feasts of the Jews is the Feast of Trumpets. And I don't have time to get into the feast today, but there's seven feasts in the Bible, and Jesus Christ fulfills all seven of those feasts throughout his entire ministry and life. And he's fulfilled the first three, Passover and Pentecost, and forget what the other was, unleavened bread. Jesus was the bread. The next feast that Jesus Christ is going to fulfill is the Feast of Trumpets that comes next. And then there's another feast, and then there's the Feast of Tabernacles. The trumpets. Well, the Feast of Trumpets, that feast, they blow a trumpet 100 times. And guess what they call the very last time they blow the trumpet on the Feast of Trumpets? They call it the last trump. The last sound that a trumpet makes. So Paul was talking about the rapture, and he was talking about that's probably going to take place on the Feast of Trumpets because Jesus has fulfilled these first three three or four, I can't remember, feasts. And the next feast for Jesus to fulfill will be this feast when the rapture comes. So I don't see how anybody can misapply the scriptures and try to say that when Paul is talking about the last trump, he's talking about that same trumpet that Jesus is talking about. That doesn't make sense. Other people today, they read the Bible and they say, well, in the book of John, the Apostle John talks about the seven trumpets. I wrote it in Spanish. Juan. Well, I'll write it in English. John talks about seven trumpets. And so they say when Paul is writing in his ministry about the last trump, he's talking about the seven trumpets. So that means we go halfway through the tribulation. Are you insane? I mean, are you dumb or something? How could the Apostle Paul be talking about these seven trumpets that John spoke about if John lived way after Paul? Obviously, those seven trumpets are taking place in the tribulation. And there's no way Paul could be talking about the seven trumpets because that revelation hadn't been made yet. You have to understand, this is the revelation of Jesus in his time, and he revealed that at Armageddon, there will be a trumpet blown. This is Paul. In his time, God revealed to him that the last trump is when the rapture takes place. But that's not the trumpet back here. And over here, God revealed to John that there'll be seven trumpets in the tribulation. Paul was not talking about something that he didn't even know about that hadn't been revealed yet. Paul was talking about a different trumpet. And these seven trumpets over here are trumpets that angels are blowing. So it's really makes no sense for a person to try to make the trumpets blown in the tribulation apply to a trump that Paul was talking about. And you can't say Paul was talking about the trump that Jesus was talking about over here because God revealed something completely different to Paul that was a different trump, a different trumpet. Oh, so much more I could go into, so much more I'd like to say. But after looking at this study, it's impossible for me to believe that there's no such thing as a rapture. There's just so much evidence. Jesus talked about a time when he would come back and receive someone unto him. Rapture. You look at the comings of Jesus Christ, his first coming, his second coming. There's two parts to each coming. So if there were two here in the first coming, there must be two future. The first is the rapture, when he comes in the clouds and goes back up. And the second is Armageddon, when he literally steps foot on the earth and then reigns for 1,000 years in his throne in the millennium. I believe in dispensations, and I believe in rightly dividing the word of truth. That ties us into Paul. Paul is in this little time period here in which God revealed certain things to Paul that are for the church, not for the Jews. And I believe in the postponement fact that God has put on hold the Jews until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled, in which the rapture takes place and those that were saved are taken out so that God can then go back to dealing in the tribulation period with his people, the Jews. Even the order of the books of the Bible prove a pre-tribulational rapture. And finally, you look at the time period when these things were given and these revelations take place, and you look at Paul. Paul was not referring to that trumpet Jesus spoke about. And Paul was not referring to some seven trumpets that was a later revelation to John. The trump that Paul was talking about clearly had to do with the Feast of Trumpets and how there's trumpets being blown. And on that Feast of Trumpets, most likely will be when the next event takes place for Jesus as Jesus fulfills the seven feasts. If you get a chance, look up my video about the seven feasts in the Bible. That's a pretty amazing study. So there it is. There's the teaching on the rapture, what the rapture is, and how it is found in the Bible. Don't give me this stuff. Oh, the word rapture is not in the Bible, so that doctrine is not in the Bible. Yeah, that doctrine is very much in the Bible, and was a doctrine that was revealed to the Apostle Paul, and is a doctrine for us today in the church age, and is what we are looking for. In Titus 2:13, it says, looking for that blessed hope, and the glorious appearing of that great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's called my blessed hope. That's what I'm looking for as a Christian, the rapture. And you're going to try to take that away from me? Shame on you. Shame on you for saying there's no such thing as the rapture. It's my blessed hope. Why is it a hope? Because I don't have to go through Jacob's trouble. Shame on you for trying to tell me that I have to go halfway through the tribulation. Shame on you. It's a pre-tribulation. Even Paul said, we who are alive and remain, thinking that he was going to go before the tribulation period. So I appreciate you watching this. I hope it's been a blessing to you. I hope you're saved. You know, a lot of these people that say there's no such thing as a rapture, it's probably because they're not saved. Because if they were saved, the Holy Spirit would reveal the truth to them. And the fact that they hate the rapture and preach so hard against it makes me wonder if they don't have a demon themselves. I thank God for the teaching of the rapture. I thank God for the Apostle Paul. I thank God for what he's given us in his book. And I hope this has been a blessing to you. And I hope that you can use this to combat those people that say, oh, there's no such thing as a rapture. I hope you can use this teaching to show those people that believe in a post-trib or a mid-trib rapture that they're wrong. The Bible clearly teaches a pre-tribulational rapture. God bless you, and we'll see you next week.